Greetings to all. Welcome to the second tutorial of the Hyperform. In the previous tutorial, as I told you how to go for cleanup for such critical forming component, those are very critical in some cases. There is data loss when importing the geometry. So in the previous tutorial, I already told you all those options. After meshing the component, you have to now proceed for the forming setup. So for that, you have to choose the user profile as application manufacturing solution Hyperform incremental radius. Just click on OK. Now this is your model. This model is already meshed. If you worried about meshing those components, punch die, binder and blank, just go for the previous video tutorial. You will get a clear idea how to mesh such components. So I already meshed those components, punch die, binder and blank, and have a look to the blank meshing. See, this is my blank meshing. As I told you, for the dynamic analysis, there is highly recommended quad elements. So as possible, you have to create all element as quad element. In some cases where quad element is not possible to create, you are free to create some tri elements. So again, just unhide the components and go for the procedure. To set up further, you have to access that toolbar that named as HF Auto Process. Otherwise, you can go for the tool and auto process. Here you can choose what type of process you want to select, or from the toolbar also you can access the same options. Like I want to go for the double action row. In the double action row, my punch is in movable condition and my die is in stable condition. So this one is the punch component, this one is the binder component, this one is the die, and this one is the blank. So just go for the double action row. Here the punch component, die component, blank component and binder component automatically detected by the software. Software able to detect those components if the name of component as punch, die, binder and blank. If the name of component not as punch or die or binder or blank, maybe the name of punch is P instead of punch. Now again go for the auto process and double action row. Now you can see your punch component can't be detected by the software automatically. So here for the punch component, you have to go for selecting which component is punch component manually. This one. So it is recommended from my side, you have to define the name of component appropriately. So here I am going to define name again as punch and just go for the double action row. Sometime it may happen the punch component is still not detected. Just again go for selecting the component punch. Okay. So in the auto process manager, we have firstly defined some basic input parameters. Those input parameters like draw beads, symmetric constraint, draw direction, datum and so on. So I will talk on those all parameter step by step. So I'm just skip the draw beads and symmetric constraint for an instant, and here I'm going to define the draw direction. The draw direction is nothing in which direction your punch will be travel. So the travel direction of my punch is in negative Z, so select the direction as negative Z. Datum, the datum component is nothing, the component along which all other component will be auto positioned. When we go for this options auto position, wherever my component are exist, they will be auto positioned. So if I keep that blank as datum, your datum component blank will be fixed and other component will be moved. The thermal options, if you want to perform the thermal forming or thermoforming, just go for check it on, otherwise keep it off. Apart from this thermal options on, you have to give the material property as thermal and other thermal parameter like preheating temperature of the blank, the punch temperature, die temperature, those parameter also we need to decide. So right now I'm going to just uncheck this options or go for off this options. Another options we have the blank type. The blank type in this case we have as a cell component. You can see here Your blank may be made of the solid elements, or you can say 3D elements. For that case, you can go for the solid elements. So that solid element case is very useful when you are concentrating on the bending stresses on the component. And this is the adaptivity level. That adaptivity level is I will explain in the results. Keep that adaptivity level as 2. So now here we have the symmetric constraint option. The symmetric constraint options is nothing when your component is symmetric, the form component, the blank is symmetric, and you want to perform the analysis only of the half component, and those results you want to reflect. So you can go for define that symmetric constraint. You have to check on the symmetric constraint, as well as you have to define along which direction your component is symmetric. So right now my component is not symmetric, so I'm just going to off this options. And the draw beads is nothing but local restriction of the material flow at the particular position. If you want to know more about the draw beads, you have to go for the forming process. So once you define these parameters, you have to go for the blank parameter. The source is hyperform component, and that component name is blank. The material that you have to select, by default we have some material library in which we have some materials. If you want to access those materials, just click on that folder, and here you have number of materials. You can add the material in the library, you can edit the material that available in the library, but in the very initial tutorial we only go for the selecting the material which already exists on the library. Just go for select CRDQ called Draw Quality material, go for select, and the blank thickness, that is very important. In this case my blank thickness or sheet thickness for the blank component is 1.5. the die component is fixed for the case, so no need to define external parameter for such. For the punch component, source is hyperform component, the named as punch. Clearance value, if you have clearance value between punch and die and blanks and binder, you can go for define that clearance value. If your CAD designer mentioned those clearance value in the design, you can go for it. So in this case I don't go for defining any clearance value here. Here we have some other parameters like travel 1, velocity 1 for the punch component, travel 2 and velocity 2. So it is very important to understand those all parameters. So let me explain the travel one. The travel one is nothing. Look here. If my punch is move in the negative Z direction, it will come up to the blank component with some speed. That one is the travel one. The distance that traveled by the punch up to the blank component is travel one. And what will be the velocity of the punch related to that travel 1 will be the velocity 1. The travel 2 is nothing. After the travel first, what was the travel first? Travel first means punch come up to the blank component. This was the travel first. So after the travel first, again punch will strike the blank and move toward the die face. So here after the travel first, whatever the distance traveled by the punch is the travel 2, and the associate velocity with the travel 2 will be the velocity 2. So this velocity should not too much high, because if there is too much high velocity of the punch, the material will not get flow, it will be stretched, because material will not get sufficient time to flow in the die shape. So right now that velocity I'm defining as 1000 mm per second, and similarly for the velocity 2 as 1000 mm per second. So don't worry about the travel first and travel 2. When we are going for auto position, software will automatically define those travel 1 and travel 2. Here by default the value is 64. I'm just going to keep this as 0. Software will automatically decide travel first and travel second. And the last one is the binder component. Here we have to again select the source component and component name. Again, the binder will also move up to some height to the blank. So the travel of the binder will be the velocity 1, and whatever the distance binder will travel, it will be the travel of the binder. So by default this value should be 0. Software again automatically decide the binder travel for the binder when we go for the auto position. Here the force value is nothing but our binder force. The binder force means by which amount of the force binder will be hold the blank with respect to the die. If that binder force is too much high, the material will not get flow from binder to the die and material will have thinning effect. If the binder force is too much less, what will happen? That binder is unable to hold the blank properly and may wrinkle appear at the edges of the die. So we have to calculate this binder force for the component. So some basic thumb rules are there for the binder force. You can go for forming tool design calculations and can calculate that value. So in this case, I assume that binder force with some calculations as 5000. Now just go for the auto position of the component. It will be asking for the auto position procedure. Once you click on the auto procedure, software will automatically auto position the all component, punch, binder, blank and die. You can see here these components are auto positioned. Look, as well as the punch travel and binder travel will be defined by the software. This is the punch travel first. There is no need of punch travel first. Punch is able to travel just above the blank, and after the travel first there is travel 2 for the punch, that is around 62, means from that position it will be travel up to 62 distance. Now just go for apply. Once you go for the apply, the all contacts parameters, properties, graph will be assigned to the all components. Let's go for apply. Here you can see till now there was no curve, material, properties, loads and groups. Once you hit the apply button, number of curves, materials, properties, contacts will be established. Now just go for the run. I will never recommend to run from auto process manager because sometime it will only create .rad file but not run the simulation. So just close the auto process manager from here, save your file. Just go for bottom panel and here we have an options run analysis. So this is the file which already saved and those are the some options for run the simulation. Make sure you should opt the options no S3D. This options mean you don't want to create .s3d file after the simulation files. I will tell you what is the .s3d file. So just hit on the run button. See, here zero error but some warnings are appear. If there is no error, software is able to perform the simulation. If there is some error, it will be tell us what type of errors are there and how you can eliminate those errors. Software is start to writing the animation files, name as A001, whatever the name of the component, clip A001, clip A002 and so on. So let's complete the process. So once simulation is done, we have to open the animation file. So to open the animation file, just open the hyperview, and I already opened the hyperview. Just go for the open model, click on the load model, make sure the load result and load model both options are checked on. Go for the open and here select .s3d file. So this is the .s3d file that I told you. If you go for uncheck, see, if you go for keep that options dash no s3d file, software will unable to create .s3d file. That's why I remove that options and go for simulation. So again, go for opening the simulation file, .h3d file. If you don't have .h3d file, you can open any of file from A001 to A011, okay? So no need to worry, but .h3d file is the combined animation file of those all A001 to A011 files. So just going to open .h3d file here. Just hit on the apply. So those are my components, and these red dots are nothing but our rigid elements. That's why software is create rigid element for the punch component, binder component and die component. Means those component are unable to deform if any type of loading is applied. What amount of loading is applied on those component, they are non-deformable because we match those component as a rigid element, and software create relative rigid element to the components. So make sure you hide the rigid element. You can see from here, just go for the wireframe mode and you can see this was the let me hide those all component. Only one punch component I'm going to show you. See, this was the punch component, and those red lines are nothing but rigid element for the punch component. Similarly, we have rigid element for the binder component and die component. So just go for hide those rigid elements and go for again shaded mode. Check on the options. Okay, if you want to see properly the blank component, just go for hide the binder. Here you can see. Okay, just hit on the play button. Make sure the transient mode is on. Just click on play. See, in this way the component is going to be manufactured, but still that is not properly visible. What I'm going to do, I'm going to hide my punch component also. Now you can see that component properly. Okay, one more concept I want to discuss here, that was the adaptivity. In the pre-processing, we defined the adaptivity as 2. The meaning of adaptivity is 2 is nothing. To cover the geometric feature during the forming process, software will split those element up to 2 level. Look, this was the element size. This was the element size. And this is the splitting up to level first. And the same quad element again going to split up to level second. So here you can see this is the element. This is the element. Okay. At the primary level, it going to split in 4 quadrant. Again, the one quadrant is going to split in the 4 quadrant. So this is the adaptivity level up to 2. So if you go for adaptivity level up to 3, this quadrant have again split in 4 quadrant. Similarly, for adaptivity 4, again the smallest quadrant will be split in 4 quadrant. So I think adaptivity 3 is quite sufficient to cover the most of the geometry feature. Up to adaptivity 5 we can define in the hyperform. So it is clear what is the adaptivity. So now I'm going to define shaded mode. Now I'm going to define as shaded element, and let me see the results. Just go for the contour options, and the most important result that we are looking for is thinning. What will be the minimum and maximum thinning in the component? So if you want to interested to find thinning only on the one component, you can select the component and just go for apply. Okay, make sure the averaging method is simple, otherwise the result will be the according to the element. If you go for averaging method as simple, it will be show results interpolation between elements and node. See, it is very obvious to having maximum thinning percent at this corners. Okay, so here you can see the maximum thinning percent around 1.2 into e^(1), that's mean 12%. That is quite acceptable range for the thinning percent. And the minimum thinning, you can say negative thinning, that is around 2.0 into e^(1), that's mean around 20%. So here the material get having wrinkle effect, and here we are getting the thinning of the component or thinning of the elements. So let me animate the behavior. So in this way this component going to be formed. Okay, if you are interested in more results like how much 1 meshes stresses are generating here, just go for 1 meshes stress, select the component is already selected and just go for simple. So you can see when the till the punch not hit the blank component, there is very less stresses in those regions. Once punch hit the blank component at the fillet edges, there will be high stresses, and those stresses are around 5.45 into e raised to the power 2. This is nothing but 545 megapascal. Similarly, you can go for some other results also, like displacement, contact force between components, and thickness of the component. So my thickness of the component is 1.5, and if you want to see the thickness after forming, you can go for that. So most of the part of the blank is defined as that sky blue color, and that thinning is exactly 1.5, because of course there is no force and no flow of the material on those regions. So there nothing will be changed, means thinning will not change, thinning will be as it is. So component thickness also will be as it is, but on those regions where punch strike on the fillet faces, the thinning will be changed drastically. So the maximum thickness we will having 1.8 on this region. In previously we seen on that region we are getting the wrinkling or negative thinning. Negative thinning is nothing but wrinkling. So you can see here the maximum thinning due to the wrinkle effect around 1.8, and the blank thickness is 1.5, and here we are getting the minimum thickness. The minimum thickness is around 1.3, and in previously we seen on those regions we are getting the thinning effect, and here we can see the thickness of the component around 1.3. okay, so that's all for this video. In next video we will continue the second stage forming of the blank. If this blank is going to bend from this edge and this edge, what will happen to the component, and am I able to import the results of the first stage in the second stage, and if those results are imported, what combined effect you will get. So this all we see in the next tutorial. Thank you.